violence is essentially the form of the quest for identity.
I don't really go around punching that many guys in the nose, and I try to avoid getting punched in the nose.
The absolute indispensability of the artist is that he alone, in the encounter with the present, can give the pattern recognition. You
take for granted processes which I would consider Faustian, tragic, dramatic, apocalyptic, cataleptic.
You've gone into orbit.
Tonight, a meeting of minds. Norman Mailer and Marshall McLuhan on The Summer Way. The most remarkable men of this era must surely be Norman Mailer and Marshall McLuhan. The one a prophet of hip and probable conscience of the nation. The other a prophet of the media and spokesman for the electronic age. Mailer's career is studded with literary success and stained with matrimonial failure. It had its early beginnings with The Naked and the Dead, a bestseller that brought him instant fame. Recent years have been lean, but last October, he joined 50,000 Americans in a march on the Pentagon in protest against the war in Vietnam. Mailer pushed his way through police barricades to certain arrest. He is now appealing a 5-day prison sentence. His account of that skirmish has become what the critics have called his greatest book, Armies of the Night, a modern-day document of dissent. In his latest about-to-be-released book, War and Peace in the Global Village, Marshall McLuhan maintains that violence is really a quest for identity and firmly nails down his prediction that the media will eventually hurl 20th century man back to tribalism. Well, who or what does he speak for? His followers claim he's a brilliant revolutionary in his own right who speaks for the future. His critics are less enthusiastic. They see more jargon than genius in his tribal village rearview mirror and a host of novel slogans that have become his universally acknowledged trademarks. Call him what you will. There's no doubt that McLuhan's definition of communication makes him at least a passing master of the media. Two men of our time, hate them or love them, but you must listen to what they say on tonight's Meeting of Minds. Here's Ken LaFoley, face-to-face with Norman Mailer and Marshall McLuhan.
Look, Marshall, we both agree that man's accelerating at an extraordinary rate into a super technological world, if you will.
Yeah.
And that the modes and methods by which men instruct themselves and are instructed are shifting in extraordinary.
We've gone into orbit.
Well, but at the same time, I would say there's something profoundly autoerotic about this process, and it's sinister.
Psychedelic. When you step up the environment to those speeds, you create the psychedelic thrill. The whole world becomes kaleidoscopic. And you go inward, by the way. It's an inner trip, not an outer trip.
Look, Marshall, from all this, you've said, among other things, that a novelist like Norman, who is preoccupied with sex and violence, is mid-Victorian for that reason. Now, what do you mean by that?
Oh, I didn't say this.
No, you said I was, in that sense, I was a centrally Victorian.
Centrally Victorian?
Essentially, I think it was.
Essentially? Well, what did you mean by that?
I don't. Surely he's
saying what you
well,
mean.
Well, I doubt whether I said that, but anyway, what was the key to the Victorian period? It was the great triumph of the mechanical age, of which is the age of fragmentation and specialism. But just at the peak of that mechanical triumph came the electric circuit, flooding in the whole electric image and world. In 1844, the first year of the commercial telegraph, Kierkegaard published a book called The Concept of Grid. He was quite aware that a new environment had formed around the old mechanical one. And whenever a new environment goes around an old one, there's always new terror. We live in a time when we have put a man-made satellite environment around the planet. The planet is no longer nature. It's no longer the external world. It's now the content of an artwork. The planet, nature has ceased to exist.
Well, I think you're anticipating a century, perhaps, but...
When you put a man-made environment around the planet, you have, in a sense, abolished nature. Nature, from now on, has to be programmed.
Now, Marshall, I think you're begging a few tremendously serious questions. One of them is that we have not yet put a man-made environment around this planet totally. We've not abolished nature yet. We may be in the process of abolishing nature forever.
The environment is not visible. It's information. It's electronic.
Well, nonetheless, nature still exhibits manifestations which defy all methods of collecting information and data. For example, an earthquake may occur, or a tidal wave may come in, or a hurricane may strike, and the information will lag critically behind our ability to control it, because there may be all sorts of instruments which are warning us of the possibility of these things.
Finally, man's environment
is destroyed
by
nature.
The experience of that event, that disaster, is felt everywhere at once, under a single dateline.
But that's not the same thing as controlling nature, dominating
nature.
Superseding nature. It's far from that. Oh. I mean, nature still does exist as a protagonist on this planet.
Oh, yeah. But it's like our Victorian mechanical environment. It's a rearview mirror image. Every age creates as a utopian image, a nostalgic rearview mirror image of itself, which puts it thoroughly out of touch with the present. The present is the enemy. The present is the, and this will delight you, Norman, the present is only faced in any generation by the artist. The present, the artist is prepared to study the present as his material, because it is the area of challenge to the whole sensory life, and therefore it's anti-utopian. It's a world of anti-values. And the artist who comes in contact with the present produces an avant-garde image that is terrifying to the contemporaries.
I still come back to my particular point, which is that everything you say, I would say it's true up to a particular point, which is, yes, man does resent his new environment, which comes always at the expense of his
own. He fears it.
He fears it. He feels a certain claustrophobic relation to it.
Sense of total recoil.
Yes, but that doesn't mean that each new environment is thereby innocent. Some new environments are worse than other new environments.
Yes.
I'm not at all convinced that we're moving into anything that represents any attractive sort of evolution for man.
No.
I think we may be moving toward an apocalyptic end to man. Successive environments that you speak of may just be the paroxysms of an
electronic world re-tribalizes man, yes.
Look, just a second. Now, surely you, with the kind of things you've written, can't be accepting the proposition that what a man is living in is an electronic envelope of some kind.
No, I don't accept it entirely. I think that part of McLuhan's genius is that he was the first man to see how totally we were living in an electronic envelope and proceeded to detail it. Where I part company with him over and over and over again is he details it, and he takes a great kindly pleasure in outlining for us the lineaments of this electronic world, whereas I'm absolutely appalled by it. I think that there's a kind of, there's a sort of totalitarian principle present in this sort of avalanche of over information, if you will. I mean, there's a lack of form and order and category in the nature of modern experience, which to me speaks of nothing so much as entropy, to wit, that disease which concerns the dissolution
but
of
you see,
form.
Any form, when pushed to its limits, always reverses its characteristics, and information overload is a nice example.
Well, Marshall, excuse me, that's not really true. Some forms, when they're pushed to their limit, do not reverse their characteristics. They merely disappear.
It's like cool and cool. You see, cool is reversed.
Some forms, when they're pushed to their limits, take on forms which are more extreme. For example, somebody, let's say, gets a finger broken, and the finger, when it comes out, is got an extraordinary form, but it doesn't reverse its nature.
Now, this isn't necessarily the pushing the nature of finger to its limits anyway, but we use the word finger in some fascinating context. I don't want to lose touch with one word or phrase you brought up, Norman: violence. Ray Bradbury was being interviewed not long ago, and he pointed out something that struck me with great force, that violence is essentially the form of the quest for identity, and that whether in an individual life or a whole culture, violence is the quest for group or private identity, without that interface, without that roughhouse, without that encounter with the world, you don't get an identity. Now, this isn't to say that identity is necessarily bought at its true price. We may pay far too much for it. The other matter, though, of reversal of form that we'd already got onto, there is in IBM, for example, a phrase that information overload produces pattern recognition. Now, this is the kind of reversal I mean. When you give people too much information, they instantly resort to pattern recognition. In other words, to structuring the experience. And I think this is part of the artist's world. The artist, when he encounters the present, the contemporary artist, is always seeking new patterns, new pattern recognition, which is his task, for heaven's sake. His great need, the absolute indispensability of the artist, is that he alone in the encounter with the present can give the pattern recognition. He alone has the sensory awareness necessary to tell us what our world is made of. He's more important than the scientist. The scientists are going to wake up to this shortly and will be resorting en masse to the artist's studio in order to discover the forms of the materials they're dealing with.
What I find absolutely fascinating, at the same time, ultimately almost repellent about your ideas, although funny, not repellent because it's so stimulating, is that you take for granted processes which I would consider Faustian, tragic, dramatic, apocalyptic, cataleptic. For example, when you talk about the scientists are going to come around one of these days discovering what the artists have to offer, I would say that they're not going to come around to it by just walking along that road they're on, because there is a fundamental antagonism between the scientist and the artist, which is very deep.
The scientist lives in a world of matching, and his idea of proof or verification is just matching evidence against evidence. When somebody doesn't match but makes a new breakthrough, this is just as disturbing to the scientist as to the educator. It upsets the whole apple cart. They used to think that science was something that went on inside an environment that could remain there like the lab. It would stay put. Sure. Now they know the whole environment changes with every new technological development. In fact, the environment is a technological thing. And so science is beginning to study the human response to their own discoveries increasingly.
Let me ask you whether you think of yourself as a scientist. Your effects are not the effects of a scientist at all. They're the effects of an artist and precisely a literary man, a writer. You're a constructor of metaphors. Do you think of yourself as a scientist?
No, I don't think of myself as an artist, but I've been called both. Now, the categories are not very important. It isn't important whether you call something war or peace unless you pay some attention to what's really going on.
I'd say it's desperately important whether you call something war or peace. It's desperately important because if it's a war and you're calling it peace, you're either deluding yourself and or the rest of the population, so forth. No, follow this through. And if you're calling something war and it is war, that's very good, because everybody then is dealing with the same objective correlative, if you will. Part of the modern disease, I'd say, is that people are fed this enormous amount of information, but everybody ends up making not only a different use of it, but having a different comprehension of the information.
No. What we have created, for example, with the advent of television, a vast generation gap between the pre-TV and the post-TV generations. The parent and child have discovered a considerable gap between themselves in the last 10 years, and likewise teacher and student. The child feels utterly alienated. The dropout in school or in college or in big business is alienated by a world which doesn't permit involvement. Now, I'm not saying involvement is a good thing or that civilized detachment and classification is a good thing. I'm simply studying these forms. If you call that science, all right. If the reporting on these new environments is the work of the artist, then I'm an artist. I have no objection to these categories. I'm not much interested in categories or labels applied to anything at all. That belongs to the old literacy, classification.
I can hardly think of a man who's attached more labels to more things than you have for more people.
But not as classifications. Classified data is fragmented and stays in place My labels say what? The medium or the message? These are not easy to classify, nor do they stay in place at all. They're fast-moving entities. They're like electronic particles, which are completely non-visual anyway.
Look, if you, Marshall, are the prophet of the media, you, Norman, are surely the prophet of HIP?
Yeah, in a way, I suppose. One of 50 prophets of HIP.
let's say a prophet of HIP. Your phrase, the white Negro, the phrase that meant a lot to a lot of people mm-hmm. in this generation that Marshall was talking about. Do you think that he accounts for you, your ideas of HIP, and your ideas of the white Negro as the alienated part of this society?
Not in the slightest. I mean, one of the reasons I'm absolutely fascinated with Marshall McLuhan's work is that it's the only time I've ever encountered a system of ideas which are fascinating, just about totally comprehensive, brilliant, charged with metaphor, extraordinarily stimulating, and yet, finally, there's not a single place in which I find a real, if you will, existential common ground.
What is going on with the Negroes, with the dispossessed?
Well, I'd rather back into that at the other end of the street. What I'd like to start with is where McLuhan and I start off being a tiny hair apart and getting further and further apart at a great rate, is precisely on the nature of the artist, because Marshall speaks of him as a man who essentially records, who delineates the new features of each particular period. And I would say that the artist does that, and he goes one step more, he goes one step further, and he then decides whether this is good or bad. And it doesn't matter whether the artist finally is right or wrong and whether it's good or bad. What he does do is he gives the people who come into contact with his art a subtler sense of good and bad, and therefore they have a better ability to determine for themselves whether something is good or bad. Now, the reason I keep hitting this notion of good or bad is that all of McLuhan land, you never find the words good or bad. You find many jokes about the sort of Victorian, Edwardian, and gay 20s indignations about
Norman,
his
do you remember a phrase of Edmund Burke's? I do not know how to draw up an indictment against a whole people. Now, I wouldn't know how to value the Western world, which we are demolishing by our new technology, or the Oriental world, which we are westernizing. We're demolishing the Oriental world and
at a great rate, yes.
And demolishing the Western world. I don't know whether that's good or bad, because I wouldn't know how to make a value judgment on such a scale.
Well, I'm prepared to, and I tell you why I'm prepared to, because I think we have certain guidelines that we can use.
Okay.
And one of them is this. Let's say you speak of the 18th century, which you like very much, and I agree with you, it was a fine century. One of the reasons it was a fine century is that man's mind was developed to a very high degree, but his sensuous relation to the universe was still mm-hmm. not only simple, but very pleasurable and very complex. And so if a man wished to encounter another man whose ideas he found fascinating, he had to get into a stagecoach, he had to travel. And on the way, he had to recapitulate the entire history of man, because as he went through each small village...
Dan Boorstin, who pointed out that the word travel comes from travailler, to work?
Yes, yes, indeed. Thank you. As he went through each small village, he had to engage all the local ghosts of this village. He'd get off at a stagecoach inn, and he popped. He'd have to, he would hear some local folklore, perhaps, let's not get over romantic about this, he might also have bedbugs in his bed. But he had to pass through a series of small but very detailed perils. By the time he arrived at his destination, he was a wiser man, if not a richer man. He knew more. And his sensuous equipment had been engaged and exercised.
He'd had time to learn some of the local languages.
Yes, when he arrived, he had time to talk. Now what happens is that when we get into jet planes, I don't want to come on and you know, be one of these, be everybody's Aunt Sophronia and complain about the good old days, which I never knew either, but I would like to make one particular point, which is that when we get into a jet and we travel 1,000 miles in an hour and a half and we get out, we have traveled through whole areas of existence which we have not necessarily gained. May be confounding. It may finally be destructive of what is best in the human spirit.
No, if you push that all the way, you see, what it means is that we will increasingly tend to inhabit all of these areas in depth simultaneously.
But I disagree with you there. You see, now we finally come to a point where we do disagree. I say that we will inhabit all these areas, and we may inhabit them in depth, but we will not inhabit them well. We will inhabit them with a desperately bad fit. To wit, we will pop into a Hindu village, but we won't know a damn thing about that Hindu village. Because all we will know is, by then, by the time we get to that Hindu village, is that Hindu village will then come to, created for itself a mode of receiving us. In other words, they will have learned how to deal with us. And what we will get is their knowledge of how to deal with us.
When Hindu music, art, and ballet comes to our towns, we surely make contact with them in a very rich way. Better than we would as travelers or tourists.
I would rather make contact with my Western music in a rich way first. I've never had time to. There's much too much between Western music and myself, so that to have this added benefit of Ravi Shankar does not necessarily fill me with delight.
The tendency of music in our time is to become environmental again. Electronic music is increasingly the sounds of the environment itself.
Distorted gravely.
To select is to distort. But Hindu and Chinese
Marshall, excuse
music,
me, it's not true. You're jumping, a cardinal point, which is we may select and not distort. We may select the best flower in a patch, pull it out, put it in our vase.
Oh, you violate the environment of the made by the flower.
Well, but there's a way to pluck. What I'm saying is that Western man today is at the mercy of his own machines. That's a very old notion and a very dull notion. But because it's dull doesn't mean that it's not necessarily true. To welcome the interplay of more and more powerful concatenations of machines doesn't necessarily mean that one's working on the side of the angels, Marshall.
No, but these machines are extensions of our own beings and our metaphors, literal, not figurative. All the technologies, whatever, and all the science in the world are extensions of our own bodies. And our metaphors, therefore, I think it was Alan Tate who said, a man's reach must exceed his grasp, or what's a metaphor? But look at the new environments as metaphors of our own bodies and nervous system.
I'm perfectly prepared to, but what I see there is a dreadful nervous system and a hideous body.
All right, but feel too disturbed. I might use metaphors to discuss these metaphors.
I don't at all. I love your metaphors. I think they're marvelous. What I don't like at all, though, you know, when I come to grips with your thought or try to, is this a sort of extraordinarily this sort of, if you will, this saccharine approach you have to problems of morality.
Ah, well. I'm
this above the
this
fray.
This must be temperamental. This unwillingness to involve myself in moral judgments. Perhaps, I hope it has something to do with charity, which is supposed to cover a host of faults and roughnesses and horrors. This kind of problem of moral judgment, it tends to involve people in head-on encounters, whereas if you dim down that moral judgment a bit, you can bypass many problems that otherwise become exacerbated. And miseries. I think this, I'd call this a cool approach to morals instead of the point of view. When you're dealing with a total field, you can't have a fixed point of view. You can have a whole series of points of view, but you can't have a fixed point of view.
Look, let me interrupt this for a second. Marshall McLuhan argues that violence is a way for a guy at this time to define himself and find his own identity and, in fact, create an identity for himself. The style of your life and your writing would seem to bear out what he says. Violence is a central part of your writing. You've made it a central part of your style in living. Now, has he defined you?
Well, I think McLuhan's on to something absolutely at that point for this reason. The difference is this. McLuhan talks about man, the same man that he calls a man in a field situation or whatever, I won't pretend to use his vocabulary, is what I would call an alienated man. In other words, the great distance between McLuhan and myself I see now, really, is all the while he's talking about man and man's relation to these new environments. I would keep saying, yes, everything he says is true if he would just add this one word, alienated man, in relation to his new environments, which alienate him further from himself. Let me go on with this now. This is really where I've been trying to get to all night, and it is daytime. The thing is that what does it mean to be an alienated man? It means to be a man who does not have a clear notion of himself, but rather contains two opposed notions of himself. For instance, if I'm an alienated man, I think that I am smart and I think that I am dumb. I think that I am good and I think that I am evil. I think that I am strong and I think that I am weak. I think that I am a tough guy and I think I'm a coward. I think I'm a great lover. I think I'm inept.
Right.
The nature of the alienated man is that he always contains opposed notions of himself at the same time. So therefore, the only actions which can define his nature are precisely not field actions, not actions in relation to an environment which is controlled from without. He cannot define himself in any environment which has been programmed for him. He can only define himself by getting into situations which are brand new for him. Because when he's in a situation which is brand new for him, his obsessions can cease for a moment. He can stop thinking of himself for that one moment as being either this or that, because he can only be one thing at the moment. In other words, if a man is jumping off a burning building into a fireman's net, that is a profoundly existential situation, because he doesn't know how it's going to turn out.
Would you say that was a valuable moment of experience?
I mean, it is probably, up at that point in the man's life, it was probably the most valuable moment in his whole life up to that point.
And he has no time to evaluate it.
Precisely, because he does not have time to evaluate it, and therefore the bad training of the past, the bad habits of the past, cannot inflict themselves upon him. And even more important than the bad training of the past is the bad program training of the past. He is no longer at the mercy of all the mistakes of the past, because at moments of great danger, or moments of great love, there's a tendency for those upper regions of the brain, which control us so much of the time, to be temporarily anesthetized, because they are equipped for every situation but the novel one, the brand new one.
Why don't you tend to consider value judgments as a profound way of alienation? The man who makes value judgments usually manifests deep alienation from almost everything.
Well, I would go along with you to this extent. I'd say that whenever a man engages in a value judgment, he is either suffering profoundly from alienation or finding his way back out of alienation.
Every time you punch somebody in the nose then, Norman, are you judging yourself to be doing a bad thing? You're the man for the good and
well,
bad judgment.
The difficulty with arguing ad hominem, ad minimum, is that I don't really go around punching that many guys in the nose, and I try to avoid getting punched in the nose, so that fights are still interesting for me. I don't get that many of them, and I don't think it's really to the point. I'd rather talk about a man in a fight. And since I'm a novelist, we can assume that I can conceive a man who's not myself in a fight. I think what happens in a fight generally is, and it's one of the reasons why some men are so particularly obsessed with violence all the time, and I have any number of friends who, you know, have a bad week if they haven't been in three fights, it's because it's their way of communicating at a full level. If they get into a fight with an equal, they learn more about themselves in that 2 minutes or 10 minutes that the fight goes on.
Truth.
Yes, but it's a sustained moment of truth, and there are all sorts of truths, and they find all the emotions they kind of find in any kind of programmed environment, like love, like sex, like violence.